Mr. Speaker, sir, almost exactly a year ago in this House, I suggested that an independent Judicial Service Commission, JSC, be set up, amongst others, to deepen the competence of judicial officers. This suggestion to set up the JSC is not mine alone. Several honourable members made the same suggestion in this House, both before and after me. And we just heard from the honourable member, Mr. Dennis Tan, an account of the other members who have spoken in this House asking for the setup of the JSC. All of us are aligned in the request, but not necessarily aligned in relation to the reasons for asking for the setup of the JSC. The Honourable Minister for Law chose his words very carefully in replying to me. He said, the way our service was structured is probably the best model for the time being. As honourable members know, time is elastic. If anyone were to have asked me then as to whether the government would set up the JSC, my instinctive reply would have been, please don't hold your breath. Then in July this year, honourable members, Mr. Christopher De Souza and Mr. Lim Biow Chuan, joined me in an adjournment motion to call on the government to study the feasibility to set up a separate and independent JSC to allow for deeper specialisation and ensure that the judiciary is properly positioned for the challenges of the future. The Honourable Minister for Law agreed broadly with the points we made and pithily put it as an issue of timing. The Second Minister for Law recounted this just earlier today as well. Should we retain the current structure and make incremental changes as we go along? Or should we split the services now to put our country on a better footing for the future? If the same person were to have repeated the question on whether the split would have happened after the adjourned motion, my response would likely be that I'm hopeful it will happen sooner rather than later. As it turned out, just 3 months later, we are now considering these amendments to the Constitution to create a separate JSC out of the current Legal Service Commission. I'm really glad to note from the Honourable Member's Mr. Dennis Tan's speech that it will enjoy bipartisan support as well. If these amendments are passed, the plan is to put them into effect in January 2022. I'm highlighting this chronology as it's clear to me that the government was already considering the merits of these changes for a while and decided that now is the time to make these changes in the interests of securing our country's future. The government's approach brings to my mind what Prime Minister Lee stated during his National Day rally speech in 2016. He asked, and I quote, whether things could get better for Singapore after SG50. Can the best be yet to come? The answer was a resounding yes. He went on to state that one thing we need as a country to ensure this is to be, and I quote, be blessed with a divine discontent. Always not quite satisfied with what we have, always driven to do better, unquote. These amendments we are considering reflect the spirit of divine discontent and drive to do better. It's also in keeping with the Singapore Justice System motion passed in Parliament in November 2021, in which we affirmed the government's continuous efforts to build a fair and just society. Perhaps this explains why Singapore did well in the Pew Research Center report dated 21st October 2021, which conducted research in 17 advanced economies, including Singapore, to identify whether citizens in these companies want significant changes to their political system. Mr. Speaker, sir, may I be allowed to flash a slide of the table from the report on the screen, please?
Please do.
Oblige. Okay. I hope, yes, thankfully it's clearer, but now it's not. Okay.
Not really. Oh. We should use slides that we can read.
The chart is entitled, "Those who want changes to their political systems are not confident political systems can be changed." So you don't want to be high up in the chart, as the chart I'm showing. Italy is ranked at the top, meaning amongst the 17 economies, its people are the least satisfied. Singapore is right below, meaning her people are most satisfied. It's stated in the report that in every economy except Singapore, there are larger shares of the public who want political reform but lack the confidence that reform can happen effectively as compared to those who are confident that change can occur. 82% of Singaporeans said that they are satisfied with the way democracy is working here compared to an overall median of 57%. A key feature of our democracy is that real action is taken to make changes essential to securing our future and keeping all of us united in purpose. The significance of setting up a separate and independent JSC should not be lost on anyone in this House. Just last month, when this House was considering the FICA bill, there were insinuations in some quarters, particularly outside this House, that the government is bent on making itself more powerful to suppress legitimate free speech and expression amongst our people. Since then, this government has repealed the Sedition Act, which was introduced during the colonial times, to rein in discontent against the government, and is now moving these constitutional amendments, which will enjoy bipartisan support, to create an independent JSC to oversee judicial service officers. These are not acts of a power-hungry government hell-bent on entrenching itself and ignoring the wishes of the people. Fair-minded people decide not based on empty words, but on real action. The razor-sharp focus of our government is on securing our people's future against the backdrop of an ever more challenging global landscape. For the remainder of my speech, I wish to focus on the proposed reconstituted LSC. In my speech during the adjournment motion, I had spoken about the indelible contributions of the current LSC using the integrated model since 1959, for which, as a nation, we owe much thanks. I have also spoken about the highly respected judicial system we have in Singapore and how the JSC will serve to strengthen it even more under the under the proposed system. Let me start off by acknowledging the quality of the officers in the legal branch of the Legal Service Commission, past and present. To illustrate this point, I need only ask honourable members, as the Honourable Second Minister for In-Law did just a few minutes ago, to recount their own legislative experience in this House. In the course of the COVID-19 pandemic last year, we had to pass 12 wide-ranging bills. 7 of these bills were urgent bills, which included the COVID-19 Temporary Measures Bill and its 3 subsequent amendment bills, supply bills, bills for providing parliamentary elections and marriage solemnization during the COVID-19, 227 pieces of COVID-19 related subsidiary legislation were also published. We were able to do this because of, amongst others, a top-rate team in the legislative division of the Attorney General, of the Attorney General's chambers. They had to be creative but meticulous, be daring but keep an eye for the minutiae of details. And all this is done, quoting the Honourable Second Minister for Law, at breakneck speed. I still recall the speech of the Honourable Minister for Law when he expressed his pride and appreciation of the work done by officers involved during the passing of the COVID-19 Temporary Measures Bill. Several Honourable Members, including myself, joined him to express our appreciation. This speaks of the quality and dedication of the officers we have in the Legislative Division, headed by the Honourable Deputy Solicitor General, Mrs. Owee Benkei. The legal branch is replete with great examples of dedicated officers, past and present, with a strong sense of duty. I would like to mention some of them whom I've had the privilege of knowing. The late Mr. K.S. Raja SC. He served in the legal service from 1963 to 1985. This included a stint as the longest serving director of the Legal Aid Bureau, which allows people of limited means with important access to civil and family justice. The late Mr. S. Tiwari, who was in the legal service for 36 years from 1971 to 2007 when he retired. During his career, he headed MINDEF's legal department, AGC's civil division, and later its international affairs division. He was involved in numerous international negotiations representing Singapore. Mr. Darren Tang, who is currently the Director General of the World Intellectual Property Organization, WIPO. In fact, he's the first Singaporean to lead an UN agency. The Honorable Minister, Mr. Edwin Tong, described his appointment as, and I quote, a momentous occasion for Singapore, unquote. Prior to that, he was the Chief Executive of the Intellectual Property Office of Singapore and held several positions in AGC. Mr. Mohammad Faisal, Senior Counsel, Senior State Counsel of the Crime Division of AGC. He's an excellent example of how one mixes heavy-duty responsibilities with regular volunteer work for our community. For his contributions to the legal profession and the community, he was awarded the Berita Harian Anugerah Jawahari 2020 Award. He was also inducted as a young global leader by the World Economic Forum in 2016. I make these references for a purpose. We must ensure that with the split of the current LSC into a JSC and a reconstituted LSC, the reconstituted LSC should continue to attract and retain its fair share of top talent with the right set of values. The legal service officers of the legal branch perform vital roles in providing legal advice to the government and playing their role in the administration of justice and helping to uphold the rule of law in Singapore. With the reconstituted LSC, there's an opportunity to hasten the pace of specialization of the LSOs to keep up with the demands of their respective jobs and the ever-rising expectations of Singaporeans. May I ask the Honourable Minister whether plans have been made to deal with this issue? If so, I'd be grateful for an outline of the efforts that will be expended on this front. Mr. Speaker, sir, laws are unwieldy creatures. The text of laws passed can be so turgid and formal that such that many people cannot help but describe it as gobbledygook. But there are also such powerful forces. During the pandemic, for example, these laws make sure that workers get paid, our rents reduced, and the promises business made to one another can be modified easily without breaking trust. And all this in an orderly, legitimate, predictable manner. This could not have been done without the best legal minds at work in the public sector. This restructuring is needed, but we must do it with care. The reconstituted LSC must stand shoulder to shoulder with the JSC as twin pillars in attracting and developing the best human resource talent in the public legal sector that will continue to meet the high expectations of Singaporeans well into the future. This will allow us to pursue our democratic dream, partnered by divine discontent, not mere dissatisfaction with the way things are, but the power to change them to the way they should be. I support the bills.